This is a blessing for Nancy and for me to be in front of you and see people that they have a strong influence in our life in these 18 years serving as an officer, but also as a soldier in the Salvation Army. And also for Nancy and for me, we are accomplishing a dream, because we have been listening all the time great thing about this Corps. And right now we can say we were there and we were impacted for the kindness and the love and warming of the people from this Corps. Again, I join to Nancy's words to give thanks to Major Morris and all the people that they were in charge to help us to be with you this morning. What does God want me to do? This morning during the Sunday school, Colonel Hartford was mentioning and remarking the power of good questions that we need to be prepared to respond in our life. When I was preparing this sermon for today, that was the question that came to my mind. What does God want me to do? And that is the question that every day we need to ask God to keep in mind, the mission and the commitment that we need to have as servant, but also as soldier of God. What does God want for me to do? When I was also reading this scripture, both letters from Paul to the Thessalonians people, I found many connections of this letter with the wonderful experience that Nancy and I we have having in Salvation Army, when she was mentioning, for example, our excellent experience to confirm our call, our calling in the Salvation Army beyond the officership, just soldiers of the army. The letter of the Paul in both in Thessalonians in the first book and the second book, I like how Paul introduced the letter when he said, this letter is from Paul, Silas, and Timothy. Because when I was connecting this with our mission in Venezuela, I remember to receive many letters, and with very respect, I will change the name from the scripture. For example, I received many letters from Commissioner Moret, Colonel David Grindel, and Major Brad Bailey. And I can see this letter from Commissioner Moret, Colonel David Grindel, and Major Brad Bailey. They were the Paul and Silas and Timothy for us in that time. And I know that how much it's important when we are serving in the ministry to have people that can encourage us, help us to accomplish the calling that God has been doing to us. Venezuela has a wonderful testimony about the power of joining together to accomplish the mission of the army worldwide. I want to share with you what is happening in Venezuela now, and what happened after when Salvation Army from the United States Central Territory made the difficult decision to trust in two new soldiers that they didn't even have experience, and also they were confused, like Nancy was mentioning. We were very disturbed because we came to the United States to stay for 3 years accomplishing or looking for some personal dreams. But when we received the notice that our visa was denied, the United States gave us 48 hours to leave the country. And was terrible in that time, but after 80 years old, maybe 24 hours were enough to leave the country. And we found the right answer in that time. Right now in Venezuela, we have 6 corps, but in 2002, when Nancy, we were there, just 3 corps in one state, Zulia State. After 18 years, 3 more corps in our home city, are ruining the mission of the Salvation Army. In 2001, before we go, two officers from Venezuela were serving in Venezuela. Just two corps officers. But after Salvation Army United States made a decision to start to support the mission of the army, we can start to see how flourished the army started to go. In 2015, six officers from Venezuela. In 2020, right now we have 17 officers serving in Venezuela, from Venezuela. 12, they are living in Venezuela, and another five officers they are serving in the North Latin Salvation Army Latin territory. And right now we have two cadets. You can see from 2001 to 2020 how many people, how many officers made a decision to join to the army. Right now we have 323 soldiers, junior soldier 29. We have 34 members of Home League, and men's ministry we have 170. This is what the original building, and what Nancy and I, we started the core. We didn't understand the term, what being outpost, but we called it core. It was a dream, although we didn't know the deep of that name in the ministry. And we started in this, and Salvation Army Central Territory gave the money to purchase the fifth floor in the corner and the left side, the apartment. That was our first home in Venezuela, serving in the core and the fifth floor, and the second floor was the apartment. This picture is when Major Brad Bailey, in that time with Colonel Grindel, started to listen what were happening in Venezuela with just $3,000 and two people that they didn't know anything about Salvation Army, but they were believing in God. That was an excellent time to meet new people and know the mission of the Salvation Army. Major Brad Bailey, he was started to preach the gospel together with Colonel Grindel. During that time, Nancy and I, we were learning to sing Salvation Army songs and the chorus Hallelujah. It was a wonderful experience how we started the ministry with 20 senior people that they were living in an older home, that they were receiving primary attention. They were homeless, and that family opened the house for them. And because I learned from Salvation Army here in Miami, here in the United States, that we needed to visit every Sunday the nursing home, that touched your heart and said, we need to find something to do, although we don't have the ministry in front of us. People start to be committed with the army. It was in that room. Just in the first Sunday, 20 people, and after 4 months, more than 80 people and 12 new soldiers. We started to visit nursing home. You said, people said, who you are? Well, we are here to serve you, but we don't know what it means, Ejército de Salvación. That means, you know, Venezuela is facing a very difficult time right now with communism, and they were confused about listening to another army or another ejército. And we said our army is an army of peace, of restoration, and hope. Nothing to do with another false doctrines. And we started to feed the people. And that was an amazing experience to confirm our calling to the Salvation Army as an officer. It was a time to help others to go ahead. And also Nancy and I, because many people didn't know what Salvation Army is, because Nancy, before we came to the United States, we have a radio, in the Christian radio station, we have a program, and we use those skills to start to speak about Salvation Army. And we, every night, between 9 p.m. and 10 p.m., we were using 1 hour to speak about Salvation Army mission and talking about the Word of God. I don't know what thing to talk about Salvation Army in that time, but I brought with me a lot of books that helped me to illustrate what Salvation Army is. One soldier of the army started to donate this house. That house, additional to the core, was donated for a soldier in the army. In almost 8 months working with or be involved as a soldier, she fell in her heart, said, I know the Salvation Army have a strong future in Barquisimeto. I will donate this house to accomplish the mission. And we started to serve there, serving the old people, homeless people, that they didn't have a house to be, but also to be loved. And also the first home that we were assisting people becoming a children home. And we started in some way to be with senior people, but also with the children. And also helping people with disability, a strong disability. They were looking for a place to receive love and compassion. Although we didn't have the resources, the only thing that we said, bring your daughter here and she will receive the love of God. And that was a wonderful experience working with children without having any resources, just $3,000. And this is the core in that time. And now, just the word that two new people plus two old senior officers, and that time was Captain Pedro and Lorraine Lopez. Now we can see the fruit. We can see it's a joy to see officer and soldier having council meeting, officer council, to talk about the Salvation Army mission in Venezuela. It's growing, fasting in the middle of the difficulties. Venezuela, you know, is facing a communism system. And also Salvation Army has been exposed to pay the price to be persecuted too. For this reason, I found many common things between the letter of encouragement that Paul sent to the Thessalonian people, because that letter is very similar about the experience that the people of Salvation Army is experiencing in Venezuela. But we are not stopping the mission. Right now, Venezuela officers, they are focused on the most vulnerable people, that are children. They focus more, all these resources, all the effort, all the strength, all the vision has been focused on the children. Because, you know, in the communist system, you can see the most vulnerable people suffer that kind of government style. And also, you know, right now worldwide, the human trafficking is terrible in Venezuela. Worldwide, in Venezuela, the human trafficking, especially for children, is terrible. They are more. Salvation Army right now is focusing to protect children and families. And right now, they are having a children feeding program. You know, there are many children that they cannot go to the schools because they don't have food to eat. And the parents, they are very concerned. Salvation Army right now, they are working with the school, and they said, send me the children to all these places, and we will provide a snack, and they will be back to the school, and they will be able to learn because they have something in the stomach. And now, officer, continue working. This is wonderful. There is a full of joy in my heart to see a strong army in Venezuela that in 2001, without Salvation Army help, we can see the harvest time in this moment. Right now we have summer camp where the children, they have an opportunity to go to places that right now parents, they cannot offer to them. We have a strong officer that they receive training in Costa Rica and they back to Venezuela to be committed to work with them. And this is the story right now in Venezuela, focusing and trying to protect families and children since the moment that we recognize that they are the most vulnerable people. The feeding program for children has been our priority. And this is terrible. I never expected to see my country facing these challenges. But thank you, Jesus, because we have a worldwide army that they pay attention in many ways to those needs. And thank you for this great initiative from this core And I know that many corps, they have that opportunity to raise money for war services, because you cannot imagine how many people can be impacted and how we can make the difference in people's life. Many of these children, they will become an officer in the future, or maybe they have a strong idea about the army that we do, that we serve. And right now, all the spaces in the Sixth Corps has been focusing on children. Children are our priority, not just providing physical food, but also spiritual food too. Officer committed. You can see, you know why you are not seeing parents in the Corps? Because all the parents are leaving the country to find money, to send money to the children. More than 5 million people left Venezuela, and they have leaving the children behind with the parents, grandparents, because they cannot bring to them, because, you know, starting new life in countries is not easy. For the reason, many children today, they are living without parents. But thank you, Salvation Army initiative, little initiative, can make the difference in one specific community. This is a picture. I have a testimony that one junior soldier said, I know that my parents are far away from my house, but thank you, Jesus, because we have an officer, a pastor, that they are taking care of us. And this is the story, marvelous story, that in 2001, we were part of this. And right now, we have 17 officers that they are committed to continue serving Venezuela to make a difference in the middle of the terrible difficulties that we have. Now, I know that there are many pictures here to share. But again, when we can see this picture, another, again, the question coming to our mind is, what does God want me to do? This is the question for you and for me today. In the 11th century, King Henry III of Bavaria grew tired of court life and of the pressure of being a monarch. He made application to Prior Richard at a local monastery, asking to be accepted as a contemplative and spend the rest of his life in the monastery. Your Majesty, said Prior Richard, King Henry, do you understand that the pledge here is one of obedience? That will be hard because you have been a king. I understand, said King Henry. The rest of my life I will be obedient to you as Christ lead us or lead you. Then I will tell you what to do, said Prior Richard. Go back to your throne and serve faithfully in the place where God has put you. When King Henry died, a statement was written. The king learned to rule by being obedient. When we tire of our roles and responsibilities, it helps to remember God has planted us in a certain place and told us to be a good accountant, or teacher, or preacher, or officer, or mother, or father. Christ expects us to be faithful where he put us, and when he returns, we will rule together with him. You know, sometimes we are very, you know, when we are facing challenges in our ministry, in our calling, it's easy to try to say, I don't want to continue accomplishing my role. But God put us with a strong commitment that we need to accomplish. There is a calling for every man and all woman in this room. There is a necessity to live worthy of the calling. But the most important thing, there is a purpose for the calling. Nancy and I, in our 18 years of officer in the army. My calling all the time has faced obstacles and challenges, distraction. Satan wants to move us from the right direction and what God placed us. But the sense of mission, the passion, the courage that we receive from the Holy Spirit keep us to keep alert how we can protect the calling that God has trusted in us. It's not easy, the calling. I remember when my grandma and my mother called me to watch the ditches. That was a very nice invitation. But the calling is an invitation, but without action, it's not just calling. It's just listening words. But God doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. We don't need to be totally equipped to do what God wants to do for his people. Nancy, I never imagined that Nancy and I can be used by God. First of all, they're speaking in English. I remember I have a blessing to have in the army strong influencers, people that they show us compassion. For the reason we are an international movement. But when I was in Nancy studying in the college, we had the possibility to meet two wonderful leaders that they made a difference in our life. Colonel Hartford and his wife, and Colonel Smith and his wife. And I remember that they were very patient, trying to listen our very weird English accent. But when you have the calling, you need to understand that God will pass you for that kind of difficulties, frustration. But when you move forward in the middle of the difficulties, when discouragement raises up, and you are sure that God brought you with that mission, the vision will be accomplished. Because calling needs one ingredient, the sense of search. Never in my life before Christ or after Christ came to my life, the calling has been very self-explained. We need to have a search, a sense of search. What does God want me to do? And this is the good question all the time when we are studying or praying or when we are doing our devotional. What does God want me to do today? And that will make a difference in our life. Let me focus on the letter. Paul gives encouragement to Christians when they are facing challenges. This letter, both of letters, chapter the first book and the second book of Paul to the Thessalonians, is the most beautiful letter to bring encouragement and hope and strength when we are in the middle of to accomplish successful the call of God. Both the first and second letter to the Thessalonians were written while Paul was ministering in Corinth. Thessalonica was the capital of the largest city of the Roman province in Macedonia. The city had many pagan religions and cultural influences that challenged the Christian faith. All calling, all the time, will face that kind of situation. Cultural influences. We don't need to do that. Other people, they are doing, or maybe this is a lot of work to do, or delegating to others the work that we need to do. If we are not doing our work, it's very difficult that we can have the joy to share the testimony after that. Paul then heard how the Thessalonians had responded to the first letter. Bad news. What was the bad news? That Paul listened. That the false teaching about Christ's return were spreading, leading many people to quit the job that they were doing in the church. Because Jesus Christ is coming, they misunderstood, we don't need to work. But this is false. Every day, we need to keep the mission of God. I know that God is coming. I know that Jesus Christ is coming, and I need to be prepared for that. But the first thing that I need to do, until he will be face to face to me, I need to accomplish the mission every day. And this is the strong thing that Paul was encouraging to them, because they said, Jesus Christ is coming, no more work, no more going to the church, we don't need to do more things. And the good news is that these people in the middle of the challenges were continuing to grow in their faith. You know, part of this letter teach us in the beginning of the letter, and you can see and when you are reading, is that I like when Paul said, this letter is from Paul, Silas, and Timothy. And this is great, three different generations. A senior and a millennial. It's a boomers and millennials. Together, Paul, Silas, and Timothy. And I like how Paul, with his seniority and experience, he said, this is not my work. This is a teamwork. I will include Silas, that was a prophet. He was a teacher. He was working with him in different travel to build the churches. But also he includes a young man that he was learning from the faith. And they worked together in order to bring hope to the Thessalonian people. This is the great thing that we have in the army. In the army, we work in a team. We need more Pauls, more Silas, and more Timothy. We need colonels. We need captains. And we need lieutenants. And we need soldiers. I like that. That Paul, he never said, oh, because I am a disciple, an apostle. No, he understood that he needed the passion of Timothy. And Timothy recognized that he needed the experience for Paul and Silas. This is the army, the strength of the army that we have. For this reason, when we are seeing this letter, it's a team experience. Paul, Silas, and Timothy were together in Corinth. Great example of teamwork. Three different generations working together. All three had different gifts and personal experiences, but all these three worked together to bring hope and encouragement and thanksgiving to the Thessalonians people. When you are reading this scripture from the chapter, the verse 1 to the verse 12, you can find the scripture divided in two sections. The section verse 1 to 4 is the encouragement. I like the encouragement words. I don't know you, but I remember when my mom was giving very clear instruction all the time. She was telling me this: listen, if you obey and you will accomplish my words, you will be a much better person. You will be a good person. What important is when we're receiving instruction, the instruction is coming together with encouragement, hoping that we can do the work, knowing our own strength, but in God's strength. That's encouragement. It's important when we are accomplishing the mission. I am very happy to see in this program that here is praying for Venezuela. This is great to see that we are praying for Venezuela, that many people that are working and serving in many ways to bring hope to Venezuela. And the second part, from verse 5 to 12, is the consequences when you feel persecuted and when you are victims of the persecutors. That is when you are facing the calling. In my journey as a pastor, I have living the two sections of this letter. Encouragement, people that they said, you can do it, you can go, we will be with you, we recognize your work. But also in the ministry, you will face discouragement, obstacle, difficulties that they try to stop your mission and your commitment to accomplish God's mission. Paul in the verse 3 and 4, Paul thanks and boasting about the Thessalonians. Listen to the scriptures. He said, dear brothers and sisters, we can't help, but thank you God for you, because your faith is flourishing and your love for one another is growing. I like that.
Without a calling, we cannot experience the growing in God. We start to love God more and more and more when we have that sense of accomplishment. I was sharing with my children days ago, listen, in the Christian life, although recognition is important, the most important in Christian life is the sense of accomplishment that you are following God, God's rules, and God's command. When you have the sense of accomplishment, you will be able to face many challenges in the ministry. Doesn't matter that you don't receive recognition. That was the pathway of Jesus Christ. He knew the sense of accomplishment in his life to go to the cross to die for us, to give us eternal life. In our duty, it's very important to praise him. Every day, we know that there are many people in the ministry that they are proud of the work the Salvation Army is doing worldwide. Be persecuted is not easy in our life. Persecution brings distraction, discouragement. In verse 5-7 says, the persecution and tribulation of the Thessalonians set the righteousness of God on this place. Verse 5 said, and God will use this persecution to show his justice and to make you worthy of his kingdom. I like when we face difficulties in the ministry. Not because we are responsible about that. It's because the ministry in itself, we will face problems. I like when I arrive here and I start to learn about some statement, American statement. One of the most statements that catch my heart was, no pain, no gain. And I repeat that. What means no pain, no gain? If you want to follow Jesus Christ, the calling of Jesus was in the middle of his suffering. God's justice is a righteous judgment. What at work among the Thessalonians, and I know that it is the same experience that we are living in Venezuela. The persecution in Venezuela is so hard because you right now in the churches, you cannot speak about justice, democracy. You need to be very careful because they can go to the church and close the Salvation Army doors because just we are talking about the government or we are using some words that the government feel attacked. It's very difficult. I never imagined that my country was suffering that kind of thing, the same suffering in another way the Thessalonians was facing. But when we believe that God will provide rest for us in the middle of the challenges, that is enough. And part of the school class today, thank you for that class because I said, wow, thank you, because that class match with the sermon. God provide the resources for us to do his work. You are not alone. I am not alone. For this reason, part of the encouragement Paul to the Thessalonians together with Silas and Timothy, you are not alone. We will help you. We will send you some kind of help that you can keep in your mind that you are not alone. It's the same message when we are trying to reach our children. That every day we need to call our children and say, you are not alone, you are not facing these difficulties alone, because we know how important is when we receive this sense, that sense of from God, that God is talking to our heart and said, don't worry, I will provide for you. The only thing that you need to do is accomplish your mission, total depending from me. What is the most important thing that I will? In the slide number 8, my dear mayor, Paul's prayer for the Thessalonians. I will let that we can focus just to finish this. In the slide number 8 that I will find right now, correct, is the power of the prayer of Paul for the Thessalonians. I will say this, the power of the prayer of the Clearwater people for the Venezuelans.
I will say that in this way. So he said, so we keep on praying for you, asking our God to enable you to live a life worthy of his call. Maybe he give you the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to do. Then the name of our Lord Jesus will be honored because of the way, on the way you live, and you will be honored along with him. This is all made possible because of the grace of our God and Lord Jesus Christ. You know what important is praying. The church, the vital sign of a church, is praying together. When a church, when a core is praying, something will happen. When Nancy and I, we made a commitment, the only face to stop discouragement, frustration, and be more clear to see how Satan weapon tried to stop our calling in the ministry was praying. I know that praying means sacrifice. Sometimes when we were discouraged, we don't want to pray. We are like paralyzed. But praying started to help us to see the picture that we cannot see in our physical eyes. That is the power of prayer. But you know, praying is interceding. But the most important in this scripture is when he said, we keep on praying, and you need to live worthy of his call. Call is an invitation plus actions. In the dictionary, calling means a strong urge forward a particular way of life or career or vocation. You know what I mean calling? Calling is a moving in the right direction. That's, it's an impulse. It's an inner impulse. I said, if I have a calling, I cannot be just all the time feeding my mind with words. I need to act. And you know, another words in this last prayer, he said, may he give you the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to do. Power of God, on God, or the power on God's power is the premise and the promise that God is working in your life, that you are not alone. Christians have available the power of the Lord Jesus Christ to accomplish the mission. But in the end, part of the most important message, he said, Lord Jesus will be honored because of the way you live, and you will be honored along with him. This is the promise of God, that we are honoring God. We are serving him, but never God will stop to continue feeding us through his glory, to his grace, and through his power. Calling is that all the time we need to keep on the table. Calling to be a good husband. Calling to be a good wife. Calling to be a good father. Calling to be a good mother. Calling to be a good son, a good child. My calling all the time is connected with obedience. My calling, the only way to show that my calling is active is when I am showing total submission and obedience to God. And with experience, when we are able to act with a deep sense of servant, we experience this worthiness. We feel that our walk is connected with faith, because faith is the engine, is the fuel in order to show me what is the walk style that I need to have in my journey as a Christ follower. But also the power of weakness. What important is when Nancy was mentioning here that we are here to testify the way that God loves us and the God will in our life. The slide number 9 said God's will is not always. Look at this. I was impacted for this. God's will is not always safe. God's will is not always safe. but it is always good because he is the king. He wants what is best for us, and best of all, he will help us get it. Sometimes we are looking for the best condition to serve God. And I applaud how in this ministry, thousands and thousands of officers, they made a decision to move to another countries with all the difficulties that it represents to go in the name of Jesus, to bring hope and to bring wisdom and to teach the God word. It's not easy, but they take that risk. What is my recommendation? Now we are ready to respond the question. Now we are ready to respond the question, what does God want me to do? What does God want me to do? The first thing is be ready to stretch. If in our ministry, patience is necessary component to grow in the ministry. Without patience, you are not able to stretch. Stretching is hard, it's painful. I know what means stretching. It's easy to speak your own language. But right now, the satisfaction that Nancy and I, we have is because we have the opportunity to learn English through. In this ministry, we can speak and we can preach the gospel in English. Although it's a challenge. Some people said, it's a challenge when you are going to another ministry. But the feel of accomplishment, be ready to stretch. No pain, no gain. God's will is not always safe. Sometimes we will have to stretch ourselves beyond what we think we are capable. For the reason he said in the word that he will enable us. He will do everything possible for us. The second thing is be ready to dream. Be ready to dream. That is not about age. That is not about resources. It's not about how capable you are. Be ready to dream. Be ready to see Venezuela free. Be ready to see more than just two states. Have Venezuela spread, Salvation Army spread for the entire Venezuela country. This is the dream. God may give us a dream that make it necessary for us to go beyond our comfort zone. I remember again when my mom and my father was calling me do to sing. I was watching TV. Hey, you need to do this. You need to clean your bath, your room. You need to take a shower. And I was watching TV and said, Mom, I am watching my favorite program. But I know that calling will be effective if we leave the song of complacency. And the calling of God, complacency, is not working well. We need to have a sense of urgency in our life. And this is the last one. Be ready to react. Calling is about reaction. Calling is about to be ready. No, you don't need to have all the resources in hand. And this morning, when Colonel Harford was talking about the Zachariah experience, the vision all the time is difficult. How we can become these intangible things. But without reaction, the calling will be just empty words. I can be a good Christian, but God is not looking for good Christians. He's looking for proactive, reactive Christians that cannot be quiet. We need to speak out the gospel of God in any place that we need to do. And he wants people that be ready to react. We may find ourselves having to react to challenges, situation, day in a day, out as we experience different level of success and failure. Calling doesn't mean that you be success all the time. Nancy and I, we have learned more about the failure and mistakes. And thank you, Jesus, because we have people like Paul, people like Silas, people like Timothy. How important is in the core, learn from the voice of the young people. I am learning from my millennial children right now. It's impossible that I can how I can be stretch my mind. I am your parent, I told my children. And my children said, I know that you are my father, but I am your son too. You need to listen to my voice. Stretching as a parent, your mind is crucial. This morning, we need to ask ourselves, is my ear open to this voice? Responsible to God? God will count you worthy. But also in your calling, God will refine you. I like that. Fulfill all the good pleasure of His goodness. Be a representative of God. That is the most important thing. In more than 137 countries in the worldwide, we have representatives of the army doing a hard work. For this reason, we need your prayer every day from this part of the world. Lord Jesus Christ, may be glorified in you. That is the most important thing. Today has been for Nancy and for me a wonderful experience to be reaffirmed in our calling, because we have seen you a sense of hope in what we need to do worldwide. That song that we were singing in the beginning, when we said, I will go in the strength of the Lord. Nancy and I never have this vision to be 18 years after preaching in this wonderful core without the strength of the Lord. When we received the sense of mission of the army, we didn't have all the information in hand. And I have been learned that we don't need all the details to accomplish God's word. We don't need to have the full picture. I don't need from God the Waze map. I don't need the Google map. I know the most important is my destination point. Destination is that week that helped me and my family to keep my eyes on Jesus Christ. I will go in the strength of the Lord. In path He has marked for my feet, I will follow the light of His word, nor shrink from the dangers I meet. You know, Venezuela need people like you. Venezuela need people that all the time be alert in order to help us. Thank you again for the kind invitation. Thank you, God, for this wonderful congregation. Thank you, God, for people that are able to listen your voice and how we can put in practice your word in a practical way. Thank you for this ministry. And thank you, God, for opening our eyes, open our ears to listen your voice. And now, God, help us to accomplish the mission worldwide. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.